Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "What do you say I am? Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah.
Thank you, Esteban. Well, it's good to see everybody today. It's a good day to be able to worship God and sing his praise. We had a lot of teacher bags up here last week, and so we took those on Monday to four different schools, and we were able to go and to share those bags with those schools, and they were really excited to get them. They were like, "Well, who are you again?" And so we were talking a lot about who we are and about what our church does, and so they were very excited to get one. Did you get one, Robin? Not yet? Okay, you should have got, we took one to Robin's school, so they should be there. We want to talk a little bit about church today and about the idea that Jesus is the one who built the church. And of course, we have the picture of the original church that Jesus built, right? You see, when you put in a search for church and for what a church looks like, you get this. Or you get the more modern-day version. Perhaps we want to do it differently. Okay, mine's on. Okay, there we go. Maybe it looks like this. It's a little bit bigger. I started in one that looked like this. That's how I started, okay? It was built in 1911, and so this looks very familiar to me. Maybe we go to one that's like this. This must be the church Jesus built because it's really big. That has nothing to do with what Jesus was trying to build. The best picture that I came up with was this. I think they're actually trying to raise a wall because a church is not a building. A church is people. But anytime you try and do a search for the word church, you come up with a building. And we, as the church, sit inside of a building, but that is not what Jesus came to build. He did not come to erect a structure whereby people might come in and be amazed, or where they might be able to assemble for worship. So as you look at what Jesus was trying to do here, he waits until the time when he's able to talk to them about who he is. And he asked that question, "Who do people say that I am? Who do you say that I am?" And Peter comes up with the right answer in being able to say, "We believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And so he confesses Jesus as that Son of God. And then Jesus turns right around and confesses Peter. He says, "And I'm going to say that you're Peter." He says, "You're right, I am." He says, "Because you're my believer. You confess me as the Son of God, and I'm confessing you as a believer in me." And on that basis, on those facts, on that confession, I'm going to build my church on that. That I am Son of God and that people believe in me, and that's going to take over everything. It will change the world because that's exactly what has happened with us. And so Jesus talks about it in that kind of term, this confession of Jesus as Lord, that Jesus is the one who now comes and we are able to follow him. He says, "I will build my church." He didn't ask the disciples to build his church for him. He says, "I will build my church." And it's his church. It's not anyone else's church. It's the one that he has built. He says it's powerful, not the devil, not the gates of hell can stand against it. And as you look around in our world today, do you really see that church? Or is it more something different. Do we see that kind of church that Jesus built? You see a lot of buildings. You see a lot of TV shows. Do we find that real power that you see in Jesus' church? Because I think a lot of times people are very disillusioned with the church. In fact, sometimes they'll even go so far as to say, well, I'll have Jesus, but I really don't want the church. The latest is people just saying, you know what, I'll get a couple other families and we'll just meet at my house and we'll just worship. So what is it about church? Did Jesus really build one? Did he want a big one? Did he want a small one? What does he want it to look like? Well, it doesn't even have a building, so we can't talk about that. And I think our dilemma comes when we start to look at the book of Acts, which really describes what church is about. Because when we start to look at the book of Acts, we find that it is split into two different, very different sections. And it depends on which section you are reading as to what you're going to believe and think about the idea of church. So if you look at the very beginning part in Acts chapter, I already showed you that one. Acts chapter 2. Peter has been preaching. He has talked about who Jesus is. It's a great day. The Spirit has been poured out, and it's one of those amazing times. And Peter gets to the end of his sermon, and he's there to make this conclusion about what it is. He's there to open the kingdom of heaven. He says, let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children, for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord God calls to himself. And with many other words he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. And those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. And as you look at this, it's one of those amazing times. You go back and look at that, but this is taken a whole lot of setup. They had been looking for Messiah for over 1,000 years because that's where the prophets talked about it. And you're able to see that Peter shows that the Messiah has already come and that they didn't accept him, that they had killed the Messiah and that they are guilty. And so what do they do about that? And he says, you're able to respond to God and God wants to save you. He says he died on a cross for you, for your sins. And they say, well, what do we do? And he says, well, you need to repent and be baptized. And so they decide, yes, we'll do that. And then what you see coming after that's pretty amazing. 3,000 of them decided that that was a good idea. And they repented and they were baptized into Christ. And it makes them form this new covenant with Christ, and it becomes this huge movement of people who are taking part in this. Salvation had come in a whole new way. It's not by a law, it's not by sacrifices anymore. Now it's through Jesus Christ. And you see what happens as a result of this in the next couple of verses. It says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers, and the awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. You look at the devotion that they had. You're able to see how it wasn't just we've been baptized and then, well, now we just go on. No, they became a group together. They were added to each other. And so as they do this, They find that they have this great bond together. They want to learn more, so they're devoted to the apostles' teaching. There's this place in the temple where they're able to go and gather. That must have been an amazing time, right? This is the preacher's favorite part, because church always looks good here. 3,000 in one day. I mean, that's amazing. That's fantastic. And then not only that, but everybody gets along. That's what you see in this passage. There are no griping people. There is nobody who's upset or angry or arguing or doing anything. They are filled with awe and amazement at what's taking place through the apostles. They're amazed at the teaching that's going on. It's all so new. It's all so great. It's all so wonderful that they don't know what else to do with this. So they're trying to take care of each other. And as this huge number of people had come for Pentecost and then no longer has a support base, well, they say, well, we'll take care of you. And they begin sharing their possessions with everybody else. And they're all praising God. And they have favor with all the, that means everybody likes them. And it's an amazing thing. It's the ecclesia. It's the call together. It's not an institution. It's more of an organic group that seems to have formed. And everybody in that group is honest. Everybody is just there for each other. They're of one heart, one soul. And as you look at all this, it's amazing to think about these things. The whole congregation of believers is united together. Can you imagine taking communion at that time? Because they did. That's what they did to remember Jesus Christ. And that's what we just did. It's the same thing. And they're all united as one heart and one soul together as they're so amazed at what God is doing all around them. And they're able to see such tremendous things. It isn't long before the Jews get a little bit upset at them, and, you know, there's a little bit of jail time for Peter and John. And so then they have a prayer after this in chapter 4. But you find something amazing coming out of it. After they had prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. What an amazing group of people that was so united and so together and did so many good things. They were dedicated to this teaching of the apostles. But the one thing that seems to be kind of left out of all of that is the organization. Who's teaching Bible class next week? Is it Peter again, or does John get a chance? What about Bartholomew? Is he ever going to get a chance to be able to speak? You've got all these different groups in homes. Who's watching what's going on there? You've got all these different things happening. How do we figure out all of this? And it seems to go pretty good until the end of chapter 4. But then there seems to be a break at the end of chapter 4. And if you look at the book of Acts, people either look at the church in light of the first 4 chapters or in light of chapter 5 to 28. There's a definite break. Because in the first 4 chapters, you have this great, huge, amazing place where Jesus has come. This new church that has started, and anytime you start something, it's always so great. I mean, the car you drove in on here used to be great if you bought it when it was new. It's not anymore. It's probably dirty, right? You don't even wash it anymore. But it used to be great when it was new. That was wonderful. And then now, well, I just really need a new one. It's the same way with church. You first come to any group, no matter who it is, and you say, wow, this is great. This is wonderful. I'm meeting so many new people. It's all so good. It's all so new. It's all. And then you start finding out about things. And it comes down to organization and who's doing what and when is this supposed to happen and why didn't they show up and this should have been done and what do you mean this is broken and we can't do it anymore? How do you figure out all of those things? And you say, well, I need obviously a new church. After all, I had an argument with somebody last week, so I can't go back there again. I'm going to go to another one. And we moved to another church, and sure enough, it's great. Because they don't know us, and we don't know them. So the solution seems to everyone be anonymous, right? No, that isn't what Jesus came to build. If you look at what happens, beginning about chapter 5, Ananias and Sapphira come with their contribution, and they want to lay it down and let everybody see how much they're giving and how great it is. And of course, it's not all that they got, and they are, they're basically trying to fool everybody into thinking we're great givers, and they're not. And God calls them on it. In fact, God kills them right in front of the church building. Right? That collection you just went by, did anybody in your pew fall over dead? How would that affect you if they did? Because they were waving that, you know, million-dollar check and going, I'm putting this in. Everybody see this? No, they're trying to defraud the church and make everybody think how great they are. Well, it isn't long. By chapter 6, you're able to see some other things that happen with all of this. So let's look at some of the blessings of what happened in this early church. There's 3,000 people that repented and that were baptized to form a church. There's signs and wonders that are taking place by the apostles. There's a Holy Spirit that's poured out on all people. They had all things in common. They took care of each other. What a great place that is. They're devoted to the apostles' teaching and to each other. They really care about each other. They are one heart and one soul. They spoke the word of God with boldness. And they were in each other's homes, making new relationships. That sounds like a great place. Not so much when somebody's got to feed those widows. Yeah, chapter 6. Not only that, but we think it's racially motivated. Because it's only the Greek widows that are not getting the food that they need. And that's just what you need, is some kind of racial bias in the church, right? Well, they figure out a way to solve it, but that's the beginning of the problems. There's an organizational problem. Okay, we get past that, and now we've appointed 7 guys, and we're going to get the widows fed. But then Stephen starts teaching too much, and he gets stoned. And James is beheaded because it looked like it's going to be a good thing. And then you find persecution coming in, and persecution is happening all the time as you begin to look at all of these different things and you realize what's going on. You realize how this is all progressing. After Stephen is killed, they expand to Samaria, but who knows what's going on in Samaria? So we better send Peter and John up there to check on what's going on up there. And then you find Paul, and his persecution comes. And he's putting them in jail and trying to do away with a lot of the Christians. And then he's converted, except for I think that's almost worse. Not only do we not trust him, but now he's come in and now he's teaching things that we don't like. He's teaching that you don't have to become a Jew in order to be a Christian. And we're not sure we like that. Because after all, we want everyone to be like us. Everybody should be an American before they can be a Christian, right? Because they need to know that you sit in pews just like this. And everybody faces the front. You can't sit in any other way. We don't want to sit in chairs. We don't want people facing each other. You know it's all got to work this way. And then not only is he starting, but Peter goes and he preaches to Cornelius and everything explodes then. He's called before the council and they say, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? And he begins to describe about the vision, about how all of this works, and about how God has called him, and about how the Holy Spirit fell on Cornelius just as a sign, just like he did on us at the beginning. And, of course, there's the argument going on, and that argument isn't going to be solved for a long time. Acts 13, you get Paul being sent out, and he goes off to Antioch, and he begins converting Gentiles. Well, Gentiles. Who wanted Gentiles in the church? We can't have Gentiles in the church. And you get all of this going on, and it's just amazing. Paul and Barnabas get into a big argument over somebody else. They finally have to have a big conference, and all the churches meet together, and they're going to argue it all out, except for, you know, they kind of end up listening to God and listening to his wisdom with all of this. But you see problem after problem after problem. In Acts 14, Paul begins putting elders in every church. But they're Gentile churches. There's no apostles there. There's nobody else. We find by Timothy, he's started putting deacons in place because they got to have some organization. They've got no organization. And what was great in Acts chapter 2 is not so great in Corinth. And so you're looking at something that is very, very different. And when you try and understand what it all means, it doesn't look the same. So the problems in the church run more like this. Ananias and Sapphira lie to the Holy Spirit. They get killed. The Greek widows are in need of food, and they are not being fed. It is obviously a racial problem. Stephen is stoned, and James is killed. Saul's persecution, and it upsets people when he teaches. It upsets people that he's even there. We know he's a felon. We know he's guilty of murder. And then Peter preaches to Cornelius. It's just not right. It's not what should be done. And you find that Paul's now sent out, and he starts preaching to Gentiles, and he forms whole Gentile churches. Who knows what's going on over there? And it begins putting elders and deacons into churches. And they get together and have the conference and try to figure out, what are we going to do with this mess? Why does church exist? You can either look at it and, as you go into a church, see how great and wonderful the grace of God is and how he has redeemed people and how he has forgiven people and how they are now justified before God and they are filled with his Spirit to be able to accomplish things they could never have accomplished before. Or you can go into a church and you can judge the organization of how it works. How long is the service? How fast were the people passing out communion? Did we get the tempo right on the song? Did we get the people served in a timely manner? How are the announcements going to go? Do we take too long with those? Is it too short? Who's going to pray? And what was a very great sharing in the very beginning, by 1 Corinthians 11, they don't even wait for each other in communion. They don't have all things in common anymore. They don't have anything in common anymore. We don't even want to put up with those people who are late. Just imagine, Bible class was canceled today because your teacher was killed on Thursday. That would make for a different kind of dynamic, wouldn't it? So who's church today? Who are we? Well, we are sinners who need to be redeemed by the grace of God. That's who we are. And that Jesus has come and he has died on a cross and his amazing love has been poured out. And we are able to be redeemed. And we find people and we share what we've learned and we teach what Jesus wants. And we are able to recognize and realize this tremendous grace of God that he has given to us all, and that we are able to be part with him and have his Spirit in us and are able to rejoice and sing praises to him whether people like us or not. On the other side is where we have doctrine and organization and issues to solve, and leadership becomes critical. Because we want to keep all the people involved. They were all involved in the Acts 2, right? Anytime they said there's a work day, 2,999 showed up. I'm sure. There's always one odd guy. I mean, you just have to give it that, right? But we have to deal with the world, and we have to deal with people trying to take advantage, and sometimes those are our own members trying to take advantage. And we've all got budgets, and we've all not got enough money for everything, and we're all working trying to keep people involved, and you don't read about that in Acts 1 through 4. That's the church also. So what was very open and shared in common is the warning now, don't lay your cell phone down because it will be stolen. We have a thief among us. Just the truth. Don't leave your purse, ladies, because it's not just sharing all things in common, it's things disappear around here. And I think it's somebody who comes in from the outside, but don't know. It makes it more difficult, doesn't it? So what do we have? How do you find church? And what I want to suggest to you today, that all of those exist at the same time. That's what we have as church. It's what they had as church. But in Acts 1 through 4, you see people writing about this great dynamic of a group that is formed together. They are all in one city, in one place, and they have this huge place to be able to meet. By the time it starts to spread out, there are issues, there are problems, there are people who need to be taken care of, and there are all kinds of things that go on. Is that the church? Yes, absolutely. And Jerusalem begins to look like that because that is true. The question is about your eyesight. What do you see? Can you see that Jesus is actually building his church? And yes, it needs some organization because you can't pull in 3,000 or 400 people and not have some organization. You just have to. Things don't work well. It's just the way it is. But also, I hope that you can see that the tremendous love of God is shared by all of these people. And that his grace is extended to all of us. And what a great thing it is to be able to share with all of these people how good it is that God has been with us. What do we do that looks like church? Well, we adopt his attitude and we adopt his doctrine and we teach people, and we are the place where people come to gain strength, and we need someone to lift us up, and we need people that we can lift up, and that's part of what we do together. It's the assembly, or it's the church. It's the gathering of people who love God and who have received his grace, and sometimes they need organization. Let me give you my favorite description of what happens in church, okay? This is in Corinth. I know. Preachers ought to pick Jerusalem every time. But my favorite one is really in Corinth, where you've got all kinds of problems going on. I mean, they don't have anything right. They've got open immorality going on. They've got lawsuits that are going on where brothers are suing brothers. They're going, what are you doing? How, that doesn't help very much with the fellowship together. They misunderstand spiritual gifts. They don't have resurrection teaching right. They're not doing the Lord's Supper right. There's all kinds of issues with divorce and remarriage. We think we've got it. That's where they write the letter to. And you've got the misuse of spiritual gifts and everything else. And Paul in 1 Corinthians 14 brings it down to this example of hope to me. He says, you got to know that tongues are not for worship, it's for use at home. Thus, tongues are a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers, while prophecy is a sign not for unbelievers, but for believers. If therefore, knowing all the problems they've got, if therefore the whole church comes together, and all speak in tongues, the outsider and unbeliever enters, will he not say that you're out of your minds? You ever had people say that? I have. Because sometimes we look like we're out of our minds. But if all prophesy and an unbeliever or outsider enters, he is convicted by all. He is called to account by all. The secrets of his heart are disclosed, and so falling on his face, he will worship God and declare that God is really among you. And I don't think the prophet does that by everyone pointing at him as he comes in the door, shouting out, "We know your sin." I don't think it's like that at all. I think it's the fact that these people have changed, because if you go back to chapter 6 and look at verse 9, he says, you guys are the immoral, the ones who were immoral, who were homosexuals, who were adulterers, who were idolaters, who were thieves, who were greedy, who were swindlers. But because of the blood of Jesus Christ, all of that is gone now. And now you are blessed, you are washed, you are redeemed, you are justified. And when you meet a group of people like that who have been something awful and have turned into something good, it's just impressive. And I think that's what he's trying to say. And if somebody comes in, you can tell. You guys are not so good, but you are forgiven. But you are people of grace, but you are people who have been redeemed, but you are people who are loved by God. And he says, he is called to account for himself because of the people in the room who are so convicted, and he is convicted, and his secrets are disclosed, probably by himself, not by anybody else. And he humbles himself before God, and he says, God's here. It isn't that we need to have a church that has no difficulties. So if you're just coming, I hope you're not looking for a church that has no difficulties. We have two. I'm not going to tell you what they are. Because you'll soon discover there's a lot more than two. I just wanted you to think when you got to two, you had all of it. So. But we're just people who have come together because of God and been redeemed and received this kind of grace. And sure, we get people who are not doing it right. They're really here for the money. We get that all the time. Or, can you help me out? And help always means money, by the way. They're here with a what about me mentality. It's not because of Jesus Christ. It's not because of anything else. And if you see those people, don't judge that that's all of us. But yeah, we're going to let them be here. And yeah, they're going to try and get something out of us, and probably will. They don't do much. A lot of times people are very quick to let you know what you do as a mistake. There are people who work, though, and never tell anybody about what they do. And there are people who are there who are constantly calling and working and checking and loving on people and are there for anything that they might need. The question is who you see when you come in. You're going to see the other side, but you're going to see some of the glory of God as well. People who have been washed and redeemed, and now that God blesses. I saw this graphic. I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. And the failure is they show a building. No, we are the church together. It is all of us as people. It is not a building. So, who do you see? Who are you in church? Have you been convicted? Have you been called to account? Did you let Jesus take away your sins? You have a place where God is. Can you see him here? Can you feel him here? Do you understand that he has forgiven people here? And that grace extends here? And that love is here? Because people are able to do that, that you're able to worship today. Can you see past the organization to the free-flowing grace of God? Because that's here as well. Can you see past the chaos to realize that these are people that have been forgiven by God and that you're able to have that church, that as well? Jesus came to build his church, and I think he built it. It's where we try to be. We are his church. My question is just, are you part of it? You just need to let us know, or perhaps you need to be baptized into Christ just like they did. It still works that way today if you want to do that. Are you part of it? We'd love to have you be part of us. If we can talk to you about that, if we can do anything to help you with that, please come while we stand and sing.